that's beautiful. Listen to me, and now we're sold on it made, and I will request it, and personally agree that I just tell you something about the songs which is about to play. The first is the song to the sacred river, and the sacred river in this case is not the Ganges, but the river close to where they lived in Baroda, the Narmada, in western India. And of course, in India, water is sacred, not only the Ganges or the Jamuna, but water is sacred. And in that typical Indian tradition, that's always bound up with an idea of a goddess or a god or a deity connected with that life-giving element of water. And a very attractive kind of idea, of course, a very ancient idea of personalizing the qualities of water or any kind of element with the idea of a deity or a goddess or whatever. So, song to the river Narmada is essentially to the goddess Narmada of the river. So the river's name and the name of the goddess are identical, and it is praise of that river, and ends with the words Naman Devi Narmada. So honor to my dear goddess Narmada. So that's the first song. Then the song of the dawn is another song, which I don't know, is it better that you first play the song and then it makes the people confused? Yes, okay.
Yes.
So let me first get this wonderful song to the river Narmada. See it dawn, and the man with the goddess, which makes it alive. So the story goes that the moon breaks the light of the sun reaches the threshold of the house where Radha and Krishna are living, and Radha starts going to the river to fetch water. And Krishna tells her, why should you do this now? Don't bother, it's very early in the morning, the sun has only just come, and why should you now have to go to the river? So he's protesting a bit. And then Radha says, no, this is the time for me to go to the river. And I already hear all the other ladies and girls from the village go to the river. I hear the clanging of their bells. I hear how they walk around with their water pails. So maybe Jam Jamna, I also now must go to the river Jamna to fetch water. So don't withhold me. Let me go and fetch the water to the river, since all the other girls and women are also going. In other words, let me have a good chat with all those people who go to the river. So that is a very simple mythological story, but which is encapsulated by a wonderful raga melody, which now Saraswati will give us inspiration for ourselves. Thank you. So much for the world. Of Hazatinathan from the Gaya Bhava Nirtan. And he did so quite spontaneously, because his poems are beautiful. He felt inspired to compose music to them, and then he was served later by Murshid Ali Khan. So this wonderful triumvirate of 1910 collaborated in creating and expressing this music. And the surprising thing was that here again it was quite spontaneous. It was not so that it's all, well, in the West, people cannot understand even the music, so let us give something for them to understand. No, it was not deliberate. here again, like in Adrian's Hold, we travel to the West also, and recreate the music with this spontaneous happening for Jean-Pierre. But then in the course of time, through the wonderful singing of Moshe Dadi Khan, that music again started taking the place of that place which music had had in Hazrat Inayat Khan's own time. And so we noticed that during these summer assignments in the summer school, and many occasions after that, during the war and after the war, when Moshe Dadi Khan was still singing these songs, I've seen a whole group of groups of Sufi Murids, and sometimes even also outsiders. People were so intensely attuned to those poems, because many, many Sufis in those days read these poems, knew these poems, and then hearing them with this beautiful music and this wonderful singing, I've often seen whole groups of Murids simply sinking into some kind of deeper kind of meditative states collectively when they were hearing this music. And as far as my impression goes, was that precisely during these summer cycles, they became kind of deeper, profounder kind of inner attunement than in any other way that was offered to them in the course of the summer school. So these are precious songs, both for their beauty, for their individual wonderful text, and also for their meditative quality, which really is so operative in this summer silence, the audition silence. And we come directly to the first song that says we're going to play, What I May Not See. I'm not quite sure that I know that poem by heart, but it runs about like this: what I may not see, let me not see. What I may not hear, let me not hear. What I may not know, I ask not to know. Beloved,
I am contented,
thank you very much. I'm contented with both thy speech and thy silence. And then that goes on to say, how is it, could you?
Let them not see.
Yes. Let me not see me who should not see me. Let him not know me who need not know me. Let him not hear me who need not hear me. Beloved, veil and unveil me as thy wisdom chooseth. An extremely touching poem, a love poem of the singer who is divine ideal, just fully, wholly content, as it says, with what comes and does not come according to that divine disposition. And this was the song which was the crowning song during the summer silences in the Suren summer schools. Moshe Dadi Khan used to sing it and accompany himself on a dilrubab, an Indian instrument, and sang that, and that was really really unforgettable occasions for all those who experienced that. And then the meditative conditioning which allowed people to reach was quite striking as well. So, what I may not see, and let me not see what I need to. So that whole complete contentment of the illuminated soul in relation to what happens to him, and to relate that to the divine disposition, what should be and what should not be. That a marvelous thought, profound attunement to a human being related to the divine destiny.
Thank you.
Moshe Nachman to India in September, October 1956, and lived there until 1957, of course. He sent back to Europe four last poems, which have been included in the Nirta also. And one of those four was "What is Needed is to Be," which in Adhan in some brief passages, so to speak, recapitulates his impressions of his experiences in the West. "Some did say that I knew nothing. Some still held that I knew all. Some did turn their back to me, and some quickly answered my call. Some said,
Some on hearing,
my voice will exclaim,
yes.
Nothing he said that was new. Some said, I always thought this. This is my own point of view. Some asked what mystery he has performed, what he has revealed, what wonder has he performed. Some said, we ask no wonder as long as his heart is warm. Some said, what did some say?
He's a man.
Yeah. Some said, he's a man as we are. What difference in him do you see? Some answered, it is not to know. What is needed is to be. So that was one of Moshe's four poems. I'm not quite sure I corrected it. Put it quite correctly, yes. But thank you for your souffleuse. So yes, again, a very striking poem, just looking back at his life, giving this impression in highly poetic form. The other poems, which can of course also hear in this, Before You Judge and You Are My Life, the fourth poem, which is goes, Why All My Feeling Heart? Why All My Feeling Heart? Before You Judge, You Are My Life, and What It Means to Me, or the songs Moshe said for Gimana in 1956-57. So, thank you. following song is a qasida, which means in this case a song, a hymn in praise of the Prophet. And it is in a highly flowing kind of Urdu poetic style, which makes it very difficult to render in any other language, because it is very involved with a poetic musicalness. It goes about like this. Tera rubba hai ya ahwat maqam Allahu akbar ka. O Prophet, your rank, your degree is that of the maqam Allahu akbar. But it's a very subtle play of words again, that it means the maqam Allahu akbar can mean the strength of the sound of God is the greatest, or it can also mean it is your degree is that of containing the awareness of God, that God is the greatest. So there again, you have that double play of the word, can be the strain, the musical strain, calling it out, or carrying it in oneself, the maqam. So, knowing of that degree, to be knowing that degree, is beyond anybody who might judge that. Nobody can judge that degree of yours in the presence of God. What relation should we have with crying? But when thy name comes, in our ears are filled with tears. And then, I don't think Kyan is but like that. Then our eyes change their shape through the tears that they and then it goes on to say, Bhalahu ya burahu khayra jasahu tumharahu. That whether I'm good or I'm bad, but the hope is still yours. And then it says, Tariqa hai, Tariqa limo ka, Nibhana apne chakra ka. It is the habit, it is the way of the noble to liberate their slaves. That's a wonderful poem. It is so very hard to translate, but the language is so involved, but the thought is so subtle and so devotional also. It's a very, very touching poem. Tariqa hai karimu ka nibhana apne chakar ka. The habit, it is the way of the noble to liberate their servants. Also in this Urdu poem, that idea of mukti, of moksha, liberation of the limitations of after in the life is present. So, Tera Rumba, thank you.
And I want to say that the sound of this language, even if we don't really understand, you can feel really the sense of the beauty of it.
It's an extraordinary language, it's a very poetic language. This is true. How to translate.
It's also music.
It is, yes, very well said, yes, indeed. Yeah. Thank you. Song is a bhajan in you, but which bhajan is it?
Yes. Oh, I can use this one.
Oh.
I have a small one.
Oh, thank you. Bhajan in you, love song. Ah, yes.
The notes are so small, I couldn't read.
No, that's true. Yes.
Love
yes. Yes. So that's a Hindu love song, in which, again, the very foreign language. It's a given a French translation, which really doesn't match the. It's not really a translation, but a free improvisation of its own. But there's a gentleman that says, well, you know, that the Hindu love song is the whole idea of going from love, which goes from joy. To pain, and from pain to fulfillment. That is the very, it is, as I say, the language is, it is a gift which becomes a death, but the death recreates life. Well, then the fulfillment is in that life which has achieved the death, like the poison becoming nectar. That's more or less the rendering of it. It's a very somewhat archaic language. Do you know what it is?
No, I don't.
Okay. It's a rather archaic language which is very hard to translate normally. And it is also one dialect which has not that, or rather than a language, it is not that, that elegant flow of Urdu. But anyway, it's a beautiful song. song is the Hindu song to the soul of the saint. And this, in this case, has an English translation, which means as follows. Thy presence filleth me with joy, and an unearthly passion doth rise in my heart. My burden lighteneth. I rise above all things. Cares of my life in thy presence depart. Thine eyes inspire me with trust and confidence, and make me drunken with celestial wine. If ever God is seen on earth, it is in one who hath spirit divine. That is the key phrase of this poem. Santa Swarupa Parameshwara. It means the saint is the Swarup, the selfhood, the self image of God. Santa Swarupa Parameshwara, that is also the honor they pay to India and the saint. Reflection, the image. Thy smiles bring a new life to all things and beings. The plants spring up, fruits ripen, and flowers grow at thy call. When day breaks and birds sing, and darkness of night is gone, we all rise to greet thee with rejoicing, O rising sun. Song to the sun, morning song in the Hindu tradition, drawing the sun. I think the first ceremonial is the one which is done by the morning. Thank you. Said, allow me to publish this song. This song is a gold mine. Please allow me to publish it. Zerbe would not allow his music to be commercialized. So I continue to be comparatively unknown outside Sufi circles. But in Sufi circles, it has made an impact which continues really year after year. So the poem. Only remember that all these songs have an introduction. You can hear first the introduction and then become aware when the actual verse starts and the verses are searched. Before you judge my actions, Lord, I pray you will forgive. Before my heart has broken, will you help my soul to live? Before my eyes are covered, will you let me see your face? Before my feet are tired, may I reach your dwelling place? Before I wake from slumber, you will watch me, Lord, I hope. Before I throw my mantle, will you take me in your fold? Before my work is over, you, my Lord, will right the wrong. Before you play your music, will you let me sing my song? That is then the first phrase of the new piece on the music. Thank you very much. Thank you. I wish that the very first soul in our time Lord, still inhabit in that Hans own time in 1925, before my judge was the second soul, but the first one that the Lord in 25, the worship was still there. And typical for that Indian culture of the time, he was too modest and too shy to present it to Mustinat Khan or to let him hear that song. The idea of going to, especially an elderly and revered person, your elder brother, to go to him and say, look, this I have done, was unthinkable, was just unthinkable. So everyone wrote that song, and Mustinat Khan would be delighted to see that one of his poems had put the music by his brother. Tragically, never heard that song. That is part of that typical Indian culture, which are more examples in the life of Moshe than his brothers. And if this was the poem which you probably all know, let thy wish become my desire, let thy will become my deed, let thy word become my speech, beloved, and let thy love become my creed. Let my plant bring forth thy flowers. Let my fruits produce thy seed. Let my heart become thy lute, beloved, and my body thy flute of reed. Memories of the lovely woman, the reed flute. Let my heart become thy lute, beloved, and thy, and my body thy flute of reed. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
started, it was intended as an introduction and a support of our meditation, of our Sangha silence, has become a presentation full of inspiration, a flow of beauty in its own right. So thank you very much for this precious gift you have given us tonight. It has become, instead of an introduction, a full presentation of the beauty, which is one aspect of the beauty of Sufism. And the wealth of inspiration which can derive from these words and the sounds of this music keeps on reverberating in one's inner being. So let me propose that now we hold a very brief silence just to let all this attunement reverberate in ourselves and then continue tomorrow.